All right, I appreciate Brother Rowan asked me to speak tonight. It's always a blessing for me to share God's word. And turn to Philippians chapter 3. Philippians chapter 3. How many of you ever milked a cow? Boy, several of you have milked a cow. I started milking a cow when I was about 8 or 9 years old, I guess. And it wasn't always the easiest thing to do. It reminded me of this old farmer that was a Quaker. A lot of you don't know what a Quaker is. Up north, where I come from, in Indiana, Illinois, Ohio, in the Midwest, they have a lot of Quakers. And they came from Pennsylvania. But they believe you can lose your salvation, and one of their big main themes is that you can't lose your temper. If you lose your temper, you lose your salvation. So this old farmer, he was milking old Bessie one morning, and she kicked the bucket over. He went up there and he grabbed hold of her by the ears, and he said, "Now, Bessie, thou knowest that I am a Quaker, and I'm not supposed to lose my temper, but don't do it again." Went back and started milking, and buddy, she kicked the bucket over again. He went up and grabbed her by the ears again. He said, "Now, Bessie, I told you, thou knowest that I'm a Quaker, and I'm not supposed to lose my temper, but don't do that again." Went back and started milking again. Third time, she kicked the bucket over. He went up and grabbed her by the ears again. He said, "Bessie, thou knowest that I'm a Quaker. If you do that again, I'm going to sell you to a Baptist, and he'll beat the daylights out of you." Well, I don't know. Philippians chapter 3. These are some of the greatest verses about salvation in the Bible. Paul's given his testimony in verse 7. "But what things were gained to me, those I counted loss for Christ. Yea, doubtless, and I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and do count them but dung, that I may win Christ and be found in him, not having mine own righteousness." Tonight, is that all the righteousness you've got? Your own? You're in trouble if that's all you got. Paul says that, "not having mine own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith." Actually, verse 10 is beginning the text. He says, "that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable unto his death, if by any means I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead. Not as though I'd already attained, either were already perfect, but I follow after, if that I may apprehend that for which also I am apprehended of Christ Jesus. Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind, reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus." My mother's favorite song was "Victory in Jesus." But you know, to many Christians, that's about all that is just a song. It ought to be more than that. Do you know anything about victory in Jesus? The greatest life that we can live on this earth as believers is to have victory in Jesus. We know the devil, the flesh, the world's against us. They're enemies that are real, that we've got to fight every day over and over again. But we can have victory. But let's be honest, a lot of people don't. Most Christians are defeated. They're defeated. One reason why there's failure to have victory is people don't know they're saved. Listen, without the Holy Spirit, you can never defeat the devil, the world, and the flesh. It's a necessity to know that you're saved, to have victory. Look at 1 John chapter 2 for a minute. In the book of 1 John, he talks a lot about the Holy Spirit and the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. One of the reasons why I come to the conclusion, I made a profession when I was 8 years old. I made another one when I was 16, but I didn't get saved. When I was 21 years old, I fell out of one of these big tall silos, about 100 foot tall. I fell about 10 or 12 foot every morning at 6 o'clock. I'd get up there and feed silage by hand, throw it down with a pitchfork. At the bottom, we had a hopper that would catch the silage, and it had an auger about this big around that would auger the silage out to the feed bunk for the cows to eat. And that was my job every morning at 6 o'clock. This particular morning, I was feeding silage. I was thinking, it was probably the 1st of November. It was cold in Indiana. And I had questions in my mind like, is the Bible really true? Is Jesus really God? Does the Bible really mean what it says? I was questioning the Word of God. Coming down from that ladder, I had a rope tied onto that switch that turned the auger on because I had to crawl across the hopper. Well, it was dangerous. Coming down about 12 foot from the bottom, I slipped and fell. There was never anybody around at 6 in the morning. That auger made a lot of noise. You could hear it for at least a mile. My neighbor down the road that I rode to work with had heard that auger going. He knew I was feeding silage, so first time he'd ever done it, as far as I know it, he got in his pickup truck and drove down there and was standing right by the switch to turn it off. Saw me fall. Coincidence? No, not at all. God had him there. If I'd have died, I'd have gone straight to hell. Listen, you can't get away from an auger. Once it gets hold of your clothes, you're a goner. I felt it bruise me up some, but didn't really break a bone. It didn't hurt me bad. You know what? It got me to thinking. I began to read and study the Bible and search for truth. I ended up getting saved in September of that year. But I knew that I probably wasn't saved when I was trying to think about it, even though I'd made these false professions, because I had no victory in my life. Listen, a person without the Holy Spirit can't have victory. There is no victory. Look what it says here in 1 John chapter 2 and verse 20. But ye, who's ye? That's believers. But ye have an unction from the Holy One, and ye know all things. That's talking about the Holy Spirit. Look at verse 27. But the anointing which ye have received of him abideth in you, and ye need not that any man teach you, but as the same anointing teacheth you of all things, and is truth, and is no lie, and even as it hath taught you, ye shall abide in him. When somebody tells me, Brother Joe, I've read the Bible, but I just can't understand it. Guess what? They just told me something. They told me they didn't really know they're saved. Don't have the Holy Spirit. Listen, after I trusted Christ, in 1965, September the 16th, for the first time, this book was alive. When I'd read this book, and I couldn't get enough of it. It was great. It was wonderful. Because I had the Holy Spirit. Before that time, it was just words. I read it. I memorized 500 verses of Scripture when I was 14, 15 years old. My dad farmed for 20 years, and then God called him to preach when I was about 15 years old. Do you have that anointing? Do you have that understanding, the Holy Spirit? Look at chapter 3 and verse 24. 1 John 3, 24. And he that keepeth his commandments dwelleth in him, and he in him. And hereby we know that he abideth in us by the Spirit which he hath given us. Listen, when the Holy Spirit comes in, it's going to make a difference. One of the differences is victory in Jesus. Do you know you're saved tonight? Is that settled in your heart? Look at chapter 4, 1 John 4 and verse 4. Ye are of God, ye as believers, little children, he calls them, and have overcome them, because greater is he, notice a person, that's the Holy Spirit, greater is he that is in you than he that's in the world. What a promise. You don't have an excuse when we stand before God. If we're a believer in Christ, we'll have no excuses for being defeated. Did you know that? You say, well, it's that wife or husband I have to live with. Be careful. Well, it's those ornery kids I have. It's those people I have to work with. No, it doesn't matter. He that's within you is greater than he that's within the world. It's what the Word of God says. Listen, folk, we can count on it. Look back in Romans 8. Romans chapter 8. My favorite chapter in the Bible, Romans chapter 8. At one time I had that memorized word for word, but I couldn't say it today. Some of it's got away from me. I don't know why, but when I look in the mirror, I kind of figure it out. Romans chapter 8, look at verse 31. What shall we then say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It is God that justifieth. It is he that condemneth. It is Christ that died, yea, rather, that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress, or persecution or famine, nakedness, peril or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long, we are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Now look at verse 37. God underlined this verse. Nay or no! In all these things, you start thinking about all those things. What are they? Mostly excuses that man gives for being a defeated Christian. Excuses. Nay, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. Not in our own strength, but through him, in the power of the Holy Spirit. What a promise. Are you conquering? Are you a defeated Christian? There's a lot of failure today to live the victorious Christian life as God's people. Look over in 2 Corinthians chapter 2. 2 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse 14. Now thanks be unto God, which always causeth us to triumph in Christ. That's the only way you'll ever triumph, is in Christ. And maketh manifest the savor of his knowledge by us in every place. Why then is it so many of God's people are defeated? Why is so much failure to live the victorious Christian life? When he that's within us is greater than he that's within the world, we're more than conquerors through him that loved us. And we can always triumph in Christ. We don't use that power, do we? We don't yield to that power. We're not robots. Every day we either yield to the spirit or to the flesh. Who are you yielding to most of the time? Well, let me tell you something. The victorious Christian life's a wonderful life. It's a wonderful life. Look at 1 Corinthians 15, 57. A key verse that probably some of you know by memory. 1 Corinthians 15, 57. But thanks be to God which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Years ago, I went in 1970 to Wisconsin, started a church, and it was just like being on the mission field. Everybody in that town just about was Lutheran or Catholic. Once in a while you'd find a Methodist along. Nobody even knew what the gospel was. And we started having people saved, and within a year we was up to 100. We started with 11. God done some great things. Well, we had a bunch of teenagers, and I had a fellow that I went to Bible college with at Tennessee Temple. I called him. He had worked at Word of Life Camp in New York, and he had a great ability to work with young people, so I asked him and his wife to come up there and work with the teenagers. We had about 15. And he said that first Christmas, between Christmas and New Year's, he said, "Brother Joe, we'd like to go on a retreat for about 3 or 4 days. Listen, in December in Wisconsin, guess what? The ice is going to be at least this thick. You don't ever have to worry about anybody falling in." It was on a lake. We rented a couple cabins on a lake, and we went and we took about 15 or 20 teenage kids. Dave said, "You're responsible for devotions in the morning. I'll have them in the evening." I said, "All right." Well, I had something prepared. But you know, the Lord woke me up before daylight that first morning, and it just seemed like what I had wasn't what God wanted. I don't like for God to change things at the last minute on me. But you know, sometimes it's good. It's necessary. And so I got my Bible out, and I said, "Lord, what is it that you want me to give these kids?" And he gave me this verse in James 4, 6 and 7. And you know, there's a key word in this verse. "Thanks be unto God which giveth." You see, victory is a gift just like salvation that has to be received by faith. You can't earn it. It's just like salvation. You can't earn salvation. You can't earn victory either. You say, "Well, I read my Bible every day. I do this and I do that, so that doesn't guarantee you're going to have victory. The devil's probably going to jump on you a little harder. The flesh and the world." But victory is a gift that has to be received on a daily basis. Do you know anything about that victory? My mother was one of the greatest Christians that I ever knew. She ended up with Alzheimer's, and toward the end, they used to tell me, they said, "Don't be upset now, Brother Joe, if your mom cusses you out one of these days when you go to see her." We kept her for 20 years. My wife and I kept her, and then the last, right at the last, toward the end, why she had to go to the nursing home because she couldn't take care of her. We couldn't take care of her. And, you know, I'd go see her, and she never did cuss me out. Never. I prayed that she wouldn't. I knew that if she did, it wasn't her. But still, I was sure glad she never did. In fact, the day she died, I went in there, they called me at the nursing home. They said, "We just can't get your mom to swallow, and we can't give her medicine. She won't swallow it. We've tried everything. We've tried blowing in her face and giving her water to drink. She won't swallow." I went in there, and she hadn't had her eyes open for about 3 days. And I said, "Mom, it's Joe." She opened her eyes and smiled real big. She knew my voice. I said, "They can't get you to swallow. They need you to swallow so that to take your medicine." She nodded her head a little bit, and so they gave her medicine. She swallowed every one of them pills and took them. I mean, just so unbelievable. They said, we've been trying for 3 or 4 days. We couldn't get her to swallow any of her medicine. And that was about 11 o'clock, and they was talking to me about several things. And then they said, "Well, why don't you go eat lunch and come back?" And so I did. And since I've had heart trouble and all that open heart surgery, I just about have to get me a little NAP, a little boost every afternoon. By 6 o'clock, I'm just about done. So I went home to take a little nap, and the phone rang at 3 o'clock, and they said, "You need to come over here. Your mother's just passed." I went over there. I preached Mom's funeral. Dana was there, and Brother Bobby and several came, and some others from this church. Well, I've only seen my mother a couple times in her Christian life that she was a defeated Christian. Almost all the time she had victory. She had a smile on her face. She was rejoicing in the Lord. What about you? I'm afraid it's the other way around with most Christians. Most of the time they're down in the dumps. They don't have victory. They let this and that get the best of them. They're just barely treading water. They don't have a good testimony. That's a shame, you know it? That's sad. Back in Philippians chapter 3, he says, forgetting those things which are behind. You know, we have a real problem with that. Usually, if we have trouble forgetting, somebody will remind us. Somebody in our family will remind us of our failure. You know what? We need to forget those failures and those blunders in the past. You can't change them. They're gone. And make sure they're under the blood. Forgetting those things which are in the past. Not only past sins and blunders and failures, but past successes. You know what happens when we live on success? Whew, I had a good day yesterday. Praise God. I'll tell you what, I can kind of sit down and take it easy today. Be careful. You better watch it. The old devil's fixing to jump on you. There's no time to sit down and relax. Be sober, be vigilant, because you're what? Your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, seeketh who he can devour. How often does he seek? Every day, several times. He don't sleep. He's a supernatural being. Forget the past. Look at Revelation 12. Revelation 12. John's talking here, and he says in verse 7, there was war in heaven. This is during the tribulation period. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon. The dragon fought against his angels and prevailed not. Neither was their place found anymore in heaven. The great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan. He's not in heaven living, but he has access to heaven. But he's going to be, his access is going to be completely and his influence cast out. It says, the devil, Satan, which deceiveth the whole world, he was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now has come salvation and strength in the kingdom of our God, and the power of his Christ. For the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accused them before our God day and night. And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb, by the word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives unto the death. Therefore rejoice, ye heavens, ye that dwell in them. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth and the sea, for the devil is come down unto you, having great wrath, because he knoweth that he hath but a short time. I heard a sermon preached from this pulpit. It was over in the other building. Brother Mike preached it. Mad as the devil. Any of you remember that sermon? There's a few sermons, you know, that you just don't forget. That's one of them I didn't forget. Mad as the devil. Well, he's going to be mad during the tribulation period because his domain and his influence is going to be cut back in a great way. The Bible says he's the accuser of the brethren. You see, every time you set out to serve the Lord or do something, maybe the Holy Spirit's prodded you to come out and work Saturday. I can't, I'm a failure. And you go back in your mind to some time when you failed God. Let me tell you something, he's a liar. He's a liar and the father of it, John 8:44 says. Better quit listening to him. We need to forget the past. We need to be a winner, not a loser. Quit having failure. Forget the past. Third thing, fill your life with good things. I'm not picking at anybody, but I'm just going to be honest. You know why a lot of Christians don't have victory? They spend too much time behind TV. Come on. They spend too much time at the internet screen. Come on now. Let's be honest. You want to know? Fill your life with good things. Good things. I'll tell you, everything on TV is not good. Everything on the internet is not good. If you can't handle it, you better stay away from it. If you can't discipline your time, fill your life with good things. Feed the spirit. Listen, the nature, we got two natures. We got the old spirit, the old nature, and we got the new one. When Christ came in, the Holy Spirit came in. But which one do you yield to on a regular basis? You don't have to be too smart to figure out that the one you feed the most is the one that's going to have the victory. If you feed the flesh is going to have the victory. If you feed the Spirit will have the victory. Feed the Spirit and starve the flesh. Now, as a little boy growing up, we usually had at least 1,000 head of hogs. My dad had sows running out of her ears. They'd have anywhere from 4 or 5 pigs to 15. I mean, I've been around pigs all my life. And my dad would, it'd be a litter, maybe a 10, and just about every litter's got a runt. He'd take the hammer and hit it in the head, put it out of its misery. I said, no, don't do that. I was a little boy. He said, well, you can take it and raise it if you want to, but you'll have to feed it 3 times as much food as the others to get it fat ready for market. But he'd give us he'd tell my brother and sister and I, there's 3 of us kids, and mom would help us, and he'd say, you can have it all the runts you want. I'm not going to feed them because they won't grow. We'd take them little old pigs and mother them pigs and feed them. And he was right. I mean, it took a lot more food to get them ready for market. But at the end, when we got them ready for market, that was our finances because we took care of them and fed them. We took care of all the rest of them, too. I said, why don't we ever get paid for doing that work? He said, you get paid. You ate today, didn't you? You got shoes on, don't you? That's what my dad would say to me. You ever been hungry? It's one thing on the farm, you always got meat. We always had a milk cow to milk. I was usually one of them that had the milker. But we had vegetables in the garden, so we never did get hungry. When I got 16, I went to the neighbor down the road and I started working for the neighbor for 50 cents an hour. Because he'd pay me and Dad wouldn't pay me. When Dad died of cancer at 58 years old on his deathbed, he called my brother and I and he started crying. He said, boys, I'm sorry I didn't treat you right. He said, I worked you hard. I worked you really hard. He used to tell us he was doing that to keep us out of trouble, which was true. Listen, when you're so tired at the end of about 8 o'clock at night, and you've been working about 15 hours, you don't care about goofing off, running the roads, you're ready to go to bed. He said, I'm keeping you out of trouble. And he was. He believed in work. I'm so glad that my dad taught me the work ethic. Amen. Folk, that's missing today. This younger generation don't know much about the work ethic. And it's because we've failed, because a lot of us were worked maybe overly hard. We've gone to the other extreme. We've just let them get by. It's sad. Fill your life with good things. Have you got back to Romans 8? Look back again at Romans 8. Let's look at verse 5. For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace, because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. So then, look at this. So then they that are in the flesh, what? Cannot please God. That's what it says. But ye are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. Ye as believers, if so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you, now if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. If Christ be in you, and the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit is life because of righteousness. But if the Spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by his Spirit that dwelleth in you. Therefore, brethren, we are debtors not to the flesh to live after the flesh. For if you live after the flesh, you shall die. That's one of the sins unto death for the believer. Living after the flesh may go to an early grave. But if ye through the Spirit do mortify the deeds of the body, ye shall live. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. Fill your life with good things. This is the best thing right here you can... This is the best food that your soul will ever eat. Do you take time to feed your soul every day? I don't know about you, but I kind of like to feed this body. At least twice a day. If I don't get at least two meals, I mean, I think I've been cheated. A lot of Christians will go day after day after day and never read this book. Never feed their soul. They wonder what's wrong with them. I'll tell you what's wrong with you. You need to forget the past. You need to quit your failure. You need to fill your life with good things. Prayer. The last thing's focus on Christ. Look back in Philippians again, in chapter 3 here in closing. Verse 14 says, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. In Hebrews chapter 12, those great verses that we've heard over and over again, wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us. Let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. After I went to Wisconsin to start that church in 1970, my brother went to Tennessee Temple, graduated too. But he said he never was called to preach. I told him if he wasn't called to preach, he had a lot of pressure because I knew I was called to preach. And my dad was a preacher and he had a lot of pressure put on him. But he said he was 100% sure that God hadn't called him to preach. I said, then you better not preach. Well, Dad had sold the farm in Indiana and bought one out in Missouri. And so my brother, when he graduated and got out of Bible college, he went to Missouri to the farm. And it was 15 miles from town. There might be three cars go by the house all day long. It was in the boondocks. We stayed there about 4 months one time between churches, my wife and I. And she wasn't a country girl. I mean, her dad was a preacher, and she never lived on the farm. She'd never been around animals. She didn't like living in Missouri. She said, I told her one time, you can go one time to the store. She goes every day. She has most of our, in 54 years of marriage, she's going to the store nearly every day. I said, what you got to go today for? Well, I forgot this or that. I told her we were so far from town, it was a 30-mile trip. I said, you can just go to the store once a week. That was awful. That was treacherous to her. That was terrible. She thought that was awful. Well, my brother's wife, after he moved out there, she didn't like Missouri much you know, what I call it, I always call it the state of misery. But his wife didn't like it too much better than my wife did. And it wasn't long till they separated. My brother went to Ohio and got him a job working at International Harvester and got him a big old Harley Hog buddy and started drinking. Mercy. Living like the devil. I went down to the farm to see my mother during that time, and she was sitting looking out the window crying. This is one of the two times that I ever saw her as a defeated Christian. I said, "Mom, what's wrong? What's going on?" She said, I can't sleep. I can't eat. I'm just so troubled about your brother." I said, "Well, you need to pray. God's big enough." When Danielle was born, we was in Wisconsin, our fourth daughter, and she came up there and stayed 3 weeks. Barb never did get in a hurry having babies. My mother came and she was there 3 weeks before she finally had the baby. She was 2 or 3 weeks late. And she came to the altar one Sunday when I was preaching, and she was weeping, and she said, "Son, whatever it takes to get my boy back where he ought to be, I'm willing." She said, "I'm willing to go to the grave if it'll help my son," that was my brother, "get right with God." Wasn't too long after that, he run that big old Harley Hog under a 18-wheeler in Indianapolis and broke both his jaws and sucked his food with a straw for about 3 months. Didn't faze him. Then my dad got cancer. We went down there to Missouri, to Columbia, to the hospital, and Mom and my dad's four sisters would come and stay in the daytime, and my brother and I'd spend the night every night with him. They took a kidney out. That was the first, starting in the kidney. 8 months later, went to the brain. After that, got in his spine and crippled him all up. They said he probably wouldn't live a year because it was in stage four. He lived over five. God wasn't done with him. He preached a revival right over here in the old building. The last revival he ever preached was in about September or so. He died in 76, in 2 days after Thanksgiving. My brother came down there and saw my dad suffering. They cut him half in two to take his kidney out, and his fever went up to over 105 and had to put him in a bed of ice. It was awful. He screamed and hollered, and you know, about the third night, in the middle of the night, my brother started crying. He said, "Joe, I ought to be in that bed suffering, not my dad. It's my sin. It's not his sin. How's come he's having to suffer?" You know why? Because God knew that's what it'd take to get my brother straightened out. What's it going to take for you? I don't know, but God does. My brother said, "I want to get right with God. Would you go take me to the prayer tower?" But about 2-3 o'clock in the morning that third night, we went to prayer tower and he got right with God, went back with his wife, still with her. Don't tell me what God can do or what God can't do. Do you know anything about victory? Victory in Jesus. But my mother was so troubled about my brother, she kind of let that get the best of her for a while. Finally, she turned it over to the Lord. Brother Mac came up to Indiana to see my dad when he was sick before he died, and he couldn't walk. He was walking with a walker and just barely move his feet. Brother Mac said to my mom, said, "Have you thanked the Lord for giving Joe cancer?" Now, you that didn't know my mother, she had another side to her. She could get like a little banty rooster sometimes. She got in Brother Mac's face and said, "How dare you ask me if I thank God for giving him cancer? No, I haven't. He's getting ready to die." Brother Mac said, put his arm around him. He said, "Well, you need to thank the Lord for giving Joe cancer. She called me up and I went over there and she told me about it, and she's just mad at a no wet end. You know, about 3 weeks later, she called me and wanted me to come over, and I went over and she started crying. She said, Joe, I thank God today for giving your dad cancer. Because the Bible says, be thankful in all things. And your brother probably wouldn't be right with God today if your dad hadn't got cancer. So I thank the Lord for giving him cancer. That's something now. Let me ask you tonight, are you living the victorious Christian life, or is the devil beating you up? Is the flesh beating you up? The world beating you up? God forbid, this life's too short. We need to have victory. Let's pray. Thank you, God, that Christ is the victory, and victory's a gift that's got to be received by faith, and it's in Christ. It's not in ourselves. Thanks be unto God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. I pray tonight that people might be honest with God, and Lord, the old devil's been beating them up, and the flesh has been beating them up. Lord, the world has had the victory in their lives, and they just haven't had the joy bells, and they haven't been as close to you as they ought to be. God forbid that we go on in that condition. Help us, Lord, to get serious about this thing of living for God. Realize that he that's within us is greater than he's within the world. We might have victory. It might be more than a song, victory in Jesus. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Brother Highfield.